Let me now move to the real theme of tonight, which was the EU-US relations and global challenges. Now, I'll try to be short as much as possible. There is a lot to say. We are talking about our modern world. We are talking about the fundamental challenges of our time and what we can do or we should be doing about them. I don't pretend to give an exhaustive answer to such a challenging theme, but let me share some thoughts again with you, some key thoughts that I believe important in 3 points. First, we all agree the world is changing, and it's changing in a way that is unique in history. This is the result of the globalization. I will not start talking even about globalization. You are all aware that it's happening. Let me just say that as a result of the globalization, we realize every day that things that we considered local are in fact of global importance. The more striking example was the crisis of the subprime rates in the housing market in the US. Before the crisis, regulating the subprime market was seen as a local issue, a national issue, I mean local in the global, in the globe, from the global perspective, it was clearly a national issue. Well, we discovered beyond any doubt that it was very much a global issue, because from this thing that we were considering local or national started a global crisis. So by definition, this is an issue that it proved to have a lot of global consequences. So globalization is advancing and accelerating. The emerging countries that we know very well are changing the landscape. And then there is a whole set of additional issues that I think we have not formulated enough yet, which have to do, I would argue, with what we can define as limits of Mother Nature. Our stage of technological advancement, and that's why also the world needs Georgia Tech and scientists, and that's why innovation becomes also, that's why also, for also for that, innovation becomes a central challenge. Because you have all these issues, climate change, energy security, the increasing competition for limited resources that have to do with some sense of limitation that we have reached on the with the actual level of technological development compared with what Mother Nature, well, this small planet we are living in, can offer us. Now put this three dimensions that I said before, briefly globalization, the emerging, the geopolitical emergence of very powerful new players, and the limits of Mother Nature, because I insist is very important. Put all this together, and what do we see, what do they mean? I think they mean at least two things that are of importance for our reflection tonight. First, that there is a real explosion of interdependence. We are not talking about a slightly increasing interdependence among nations. We are talking about an explosion of interdependence. We are talking about a situation where issues become global challenges extremely quickly. Think of the case of Greece. We are talking about an acceleration which is really more of an explosion than an acceleration of the interdependence, I would argue. And also, there is another very interesting phenomenon that is changing the world history, is that up to now, or up to the at least the second part of the last century, the geopolitical changes were the result of a well-established pattern where the emerging nations were accumulating power, were projecting that power, were projecting this through diplomacy, then through war, because war was the projection, the continuation of diplomacy. That's where the expression came from, because this is exactly what it was. It was a conflict of the total power of the emerging nations against the more established power, big battles, big wars that change the geopolitics. Now the geopolitics are changing, but are changing not because of diplomacy or wars. They are changing because of economic and other issues that I mentioned, the global challenges that I mentioned. The power of the emerging countries is not because they send armies around the world. It's not even their diplomacy. They can be very discreet with their diplomacy, but their power is economic, and it's the positioning that they have in order to be able to be part of the solution of the big global challenges of the future. And that's something that I think we have not incorporated enough in our thinking about foreign policy and international relations. Now, in that context of very rapidly intensifying and increasing challenges, and particularly global challenges, that means challenges that are not, that cannot be dealt with by any one nation. Yeah? The public policy, you see a public policy that I think, despite our sense of self-satisfaction of how intelligent people we are, how sophisticated nations we are, how much savoir-faire we have, in fact, we see constantly that public policy cannot rise to the challenge. Think of the biggest global challenges of the time, climate change. We know very well, and in fact, the biggest nations around the world recognize that we need to do something about it. There is a debate, but fundamentally, the big actors, we have all agreed in the Copenhagen, in the last summit on climate change, we all agree that we need to do something about it. But we have great difficulties to formulate a policy answer. The same trade policy, DDA, the Doha Development Agenda, WTO, the next round, we all agree that it's very important. It's very important for prosperity, for global prosperity. It's very important for the poorest nations that we need to do something about. Well, the whole thing is stuck for too long, and we don't have really an answer. Look at the need of financial regulation. We know that to a very great extent, the last financial crisis was due to the lack of proper regulation. We need to create a global regulatory framework that will prevent other crises of the kind. Well, we have great difficulties to come up with a solution. Think of other things like the stimulus package to fight the downturn. We have the reasonable coordination within the G20, but we need now to define exit strategies from the stimulus package. How do we equilibrate between fiscal sustainability and still supporting growth, etc., etc.? What I mean is, when we talk about the EU-US and global challenges, it's important to have these main ideas, I think, in mind. If not, we do not really recognize what we are talking about. We are talking about an exploding interdependence, a situation where global challenges become every day much more important, and where countries or public authorities have to struggle to rise to the challenge. Now that's true for also this formidable EU-US relation. Let me now turn to the EU-US itself, okay? But don't forget the context, because I think if we don't have the context, we come to a lot of misunderstandings. The EU-US, very briefly, this is a formidable relationship. There is, to start with, I would say just three or four sentences, but not to forget that this relationship has an economic foundation which is absolutely unique in the world. I will not bother you with figures and statistics, just one. If you take the size of the transatlantic economy and you define the size of the transatlantic economy as the total sales of companies invested from the other side of the Atlantic, yeah? You have companies invested from the other side of the Atlantic on both sides of the Atlantic. Yeah? If you take the total sales of those companies, the best estimate available is that we are at a figure of around 4 trillion annually. This is what you can define the size of the transatlantic economy. Now, in order to understand what it means, if you compare this with the size of the US economy or the EU economy, in fact, we are talking at something close to the one-third of the US economy. The transatlantic economy is something like one-third of the US or the EU economy. This figure only, I think, tells the story much better than big books. We are talking about a common foundation of economic interest, which is absolutely unique in the world. But in terms of foreign policy, there is a big debate about the evolution of foreign policy with the Obama administration, the new Lisbon Treaty in the EU. There are basically two concepts. Again, making a long story short, there are basically two concepts that have traditionally distinguished the European, whatever you can define European, the common ground of Europeans, because there is not one or only one European foreign policy, but the European foreign policy from the US. And this is the different emphasis that we put on two issues. First, multilateralism compared with a US orientation towards more unilateral action, and the use of force in international relations. Obviously, America, having the military might that it has, has been much more inclined to use it than the Europeans, who did not have it. It's very difficult to use something that you don't have, right? But it's also the whole attitude towards war and use of force that finds its roots to what I said, I think, about the attitude towards war of the Europeans. On both sides, we have seen a very impressive change the last years, in fact. On the EU side, with the Lisbon Treaty, one of the main objectives of the Lisbon Treaty is to increase the ability to project a more coherent foreign policy, to project an EU that can cope with all the instruments of foreign policy, and this is to be seen with the evolution of the last years in the EU, where we have created a security and defense policy of the EU as such, and something not well enough understood in this country only too often. We have created in a period of a few years also the military capabilities to act where it's needed. Again, the Europeans do not have the ambition to create the big army to engage into great wars. That's not the issue at all. The issue is to create a military capability that makes us able to manage crises, to defend, to protect people, and defend the values that we believe in. So it's not the same kind of military capability, but we have a very significant ability to act around the world, including with hard power. And this evolution was matched with a different evolution from the US side, where through the second Bush term, and particularly with the arrival of the Obama administration, there was a very strong evolution of the definition of the foreign policy towards others count more multilateralism. We cannot do it all alone. The three D's of the Obama foreign policy: diplomacy, development, and defense. So there has been an evolution of both sides on what were the two main issues that historically kept us a little bit apart. And as we became more involved in crisis management around the world, and we were using our own instruments to manage those crises, we found ourselves much closer to the Americans than ever. Now, again, coming to the conclusion, I tried to paint you parts of a wider picture, what the EU really is, the essence of the EU, a space of individual freedom, a promotion of our fundamental values, and the rejection of war, really, working for peace and hoping that the whole world will follow the same path. That's what the EU is in essence. Then a world where the global challenges are multiplying and increasing, were things that we considered national or regional, in fact, are becoming part of the global challenge, where we become enormously interdependent, more interdependent every day, where there is, and I repeat, I don't think it's an exaggeration, there is an explosion of interdependence. And in this big world, the two biggest players, which is the EU and the US, are evolving in a direction that brings us closer together. And still, we are not fully able, in the whole range of the major global challenges of the day, to claim that we are dealing with those in any really convincing way. This situation, in fact, creates what I would define, and I believe very much is the case, a moment of opportunity for the transatlantic relations, because we share this feeling very strongly and with increasing power. And people might not formulate this as I did tonight, but I think the fundamentals of what I described is what is really dominating the key policymakers on both sides of the Atlantic. We know that we have to do much better. We know that in order to do much better, we need to get closer and work with much more effective and closer cooperation than in the past. And we have a situation where we are evolving towards each other. Where we have seen these last years, we come into a rapprochement in a certain way, intellectually, that we need now to translate into capability of effective action. And that's where we are. We are really coming out to a moment, out of a phase of deep transition, because that's what we are in. Since the beginning of the Obama administration, first the Obama administration and then ourselves. We are coming slowly but surely out of this period of transition, and we have the increasingly urgent need to deal with increasingly more challenging global challenges, more challenging global challenges, but that's what it is. And as we do that, we certainly have the sense of the size of what needs to be done, but also the deeper feeling that there is only one way to do it, which is to get closer together and work with an increased coherence and an increased commitment to what is and will remain an indispensable partnership for the whole world, for the prosperity and the security of our citizens on both sides of the Atlantic. Thank you for your attention, and I look forward to your questions.